الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا، اللهم أمين. We're continuing to cover the topic we have been covering for some time, raising a great Muslim generation. Today we are going to take you to see a model and a structure of what the greatest ever Muslim generation used to do. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Khayrul quruni qarni." The best of generations is my generation. ثم الذين يلونهم. Then the following generation. ثم الذين يلونهم. Then the second following generation. And he stopped. So he is basically setting these three generations as the top, la creme de la crop. This is the best generations that Allah has given this ummah. So what was great about those generations? Let us talk about the generation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I'm addressing this basically to our youth and our young children, but of course to you, the parents, so that you can communicate this as a message to your children. Our children who are raised here, they always play the excuse of the society, the peer pressure. We are not in a Muslim society. But that's exactly where the greatest generation was raised to be. Umar ibn Khattab was not a Muslim. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not a Muslim before he was commissioned as a Muslim. He learned Islam as the revelation started to come. Know that Allah is the only ilah, and all of this, it came to him through the revelation. Abu Bakr was not a Muslim. So the greatest companions around the Prophet were raised in a non-Muslim society. So this false excuse that we are in a non-Muslim society that is actually playing very well with us parents is a no excuse. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to divide people in the hereafter, say, were you raised in a Muslim society? Were you raised in a non-Muslim society? No. Are you a Muslim or are you not? Did you submit when you get the message? So if they can make the argument, and I'm talking about our children, our youth in particular, if they can make the argument that the society is not Muslim, therefore I have all of these shortcomings, then they can also reach the logic and the common sense that that is not an excuse. Islam is not something that you mince yourself in and then you become a Muslim, or you get minced in or dyed in when you are young. Islam doesn't need baptizing. You know, in the Baptist religion, if you're baptized, you are a Baptist. Finished. There is no such a thing in Islam. Islam is not a religion that you inherit. Islam is a conscientious decision that you make. Do you want to submit? Allah asks. فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Are you going to act and submit and surrender to the will of Allah, or do you want to get the other choice. Allah tells us that Islam is a willful, voluntary choice, not something that you coerce somebody to accept. Let there be no compulsion in religion. لا إكراه في الدين. ولو شاء ربك لجعل الناس أمة واحدة ولا يزالون مختلفين. Allah did not mean, He did not will to make us all one side or the other. He wants us all to submit, but He did not want to coerce us to submit. He could have. ولو شاء ربك لآمن من في الأرض كلهم جميعا. If Allah had willed that all people on earth would have submitted, He would have created them in submission as He did the angels. So Islam is a willful, voluntary choice. It is not something you inherit from your family. It is not something that you copy from somebody. It has to be a faith that is settled in the heart and confirmed by the action. It has to be a choice. So the early generations around the Prophet ﷺ were all in willful surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu arda heard, I think it was Surah Taha, when his sister was reading as he went to visit her to chastise her about her faith, and he ended up hitting her and her husband because of their submission. But then it came to him, Allah opened his heart, and he went directly from there to the Prophet ﷺ to declare his Islam. Umar al-Khattab, who just hit his sister and her husband, almost killed them, and he left, and Allah made him reflect on what he has heard. طَاهَا مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى إِلَّا تَذْكِرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. All of these beautiful ayat with the rhyming and the deep meaning it carries about the hope for humanity, for the Prophet, for those who follow the message. And he says, why? There were some people around the Prophet who used to say, Umar will not believe until his donkey believes. حَتَّى يُسْلِمَ حِمَارُ الْخَطَّابِ. Because of the stubbornness that was shielding him away from Islam. When it opened up, when Allah opened his heart, and when he opened his heart for the message, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about this, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحْ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. He whom Allah wants to guide, he would open up his chest, his heart for Islam. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ أَنْ يُضِلَّهُ يَجْعَلْ صَدْرَهُ ضَيِّقًا حَرَجًا كَأَنَّمَا يَصَعَدُ فِي السَّمَاءِ. If he wants somebody to go astray, he would make his chest so tight as if he's being ascended all the way up to heaven. We all know that when you ascend up to heaven, there's always less oxygen. And that's what makes your chest so tight. It's one of those miraculous ayah and expressions. The Prophet ﷺ did not fly. He didn't experience this. But this is the Quran. It comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Umar ibn Khattab goes directly to the Prophet ﷺ to surrender. And he was seen by one of the companions. And the Prophet ﷺ thought that he is coming to fight. So the Prophet ﷺ would hold him from his clothing. أَمَا أَنَا لَكَ يَا عُمَرْ. Isn't it about time, O Umar? And the Prophet ﷺ was praying for him or for Amr ibn Hisham, another zealot mushrik who was also persecuting Muslims. So he asked Allah, said, Allahumma ansur al-Islam bi-ahad al-umarain. O Allah, give the support for Islam by inviting and opening the hearts of one of the two Umars, Umar ibn al-Khattab or Amr ibn Hisham. And Allah answered his prayer for Umar ibn al-Khattab, subhanallah, yahdi man yasha. So Umar came, the Prophet ﷺ held him from his clothing and he said, isn't it time, Umar, to come and submit and surrender? And he said, yes, Rasulullah, subhanallah. So here is Umar, was not only a non-Muslim, he was fighting Islam and Muslims. He was persecuting his own servants. But when he became the Muslim, and Hamza ibn Abi Talib became a Muslim, just two. They lined up Muslims and they marched through Mecca. And when Umar ibn al-Khattab was marching with Hamza radiallahu anhu arda, the cousin of the Prophet, and the Muslims lined up in two lines after them, it was a march to show that we are here to stay, we are here to defend our faith, and we are not afraid to say we are all Muslims. The servant, the shopkeeper, the merchant, the businessman, the wealthy people, the poor people, the helpless, we are all one community and one family. Just on a side note, there are some scholars today, unfortunately, who are saying that demonstrations have nothing to do with Islam. I think now we know it does. You demonstrate to push against those who want to silence you. You stand up to be taller than those who want to minimize you. You stand together to scare those who want you to be divided, to break your ranks. That's what Islam is. So if I am weak alone, the Prophet ﷺ says, "Al-mar'u qalilun bi nafsihi, kathirun bi ikhwanihi." A person alone is weak by himself, but he is quite a force when he comes together with his brothers and sisters. So let our children understand that the history of Muslims did not start in Andalusia. The history of Muslims did not start in America. I encourage you to give your children a chance to live in a Muslim country. And I don't want to hear the issue, where is the Muslim country? There is no perfect Muslim country. The Medina was not solidified until people pushed back against all of the enemies. But even then, wars never ended against Islam. There is no such a thing as the last war against Muslims. And I'm not making this up, and this is not a political statement. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ حَتَّى يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَنْ دِينِكُمْ إِنِ اسْتَطَعُوا. They will continue forever to fight you until they turn you away from your faith, if they can. When can they? If we give them the chance. If we lower our back, somebody is bound to like it, will take us for a ride. If you stand tall and straight, nobody can take your ummah for a ride. So our children, to follow on the footsteps of these people, they need to listen to the companions. When the Prophet ﷺ was faced with some challenges in Medina, and he was concerned about the impending attack, he consulted some of the leaders of Al-Ansar Al-Muhajirin, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and others, and he told them, I am thinking to give them part of the dates of Medina. Maybe this will save some blood. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh said, Prophet Muhammad, we didn't do that in the days of Jahiliyyah. We never caved into pressure, even in the days of Jahiliyyah. How come now that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has empowered us with our faith that we give up? That was not the spirit. Our children are giving up to the slightest pressure. It's like cellophane paper. It's just unbelievable. I believe we should give our children a dose of real faith to understand what the word La ilaha illallah means. What the word Muhammadun Rasulullah means. For the companions of the Prophet, it meant dignity, it meant power, it meant resilience, it meant tawakkul ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to rely on Allah, to trust Allah, and to be kind and good to everybody, but to be strong when attacked, to push back when persecuted. You do not accept to be the underdog for centuries. That's not a Muslim. A Muslim doesn't submit but to Allah. They also understood from the very first moment they listened to the Quran, they understood that Islam is not just a social reformation system, even though that's part of our mission. Islam is not a political reformation system, even though that is part of our mission. Islam, primarily for them, as it should be for us, was a self-reformation system. And their way of da'wah was primarily 99% by role model. People who accepted Islam after this generation and through this generation, it was by one of two things. Either they were Arabs who understood what the Arabic language means when it says La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, they understood it very well, or they saw role models of people whose behavior reflected and presented Islam in the purest and most articulate way in practice. Those of us who come from the sub-Indian continent, they know that their ancestors accepted Islam based on merchants going through their villages. Muslim merchants who went against the norm and the culture by their own faith, by the way they worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the way they conducted themselves in business, and they liked it. We want to be those types of Muslims. We want our manners to speak for us. We want our ethics and principles as we live them in real life to speak for Islam. We want our behavior, how we relate to others, our love and care and compassion to speak for Islam. But unfortunately, some Muslims are engaged in practices that give Islam not just one black eye, two black eyes. When we cheat, when we lie, when we renege on our promises, all of those behaviors make Islam despicable in the eyes of those who don't understand Islam. And we should not blame them. We should blame ourselves. We should take this responsibility of turning the coin for the reputation and the image of Islam, not by talking about it, but by doing what the Prophet ﷺ did. The Prophet ﷺ, when Aisha was asked about his manners, كيف كان خلق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, what does she say? When she was asked, how was the manners of the Prophet ﷺ? She said, his manners were the Quran. If you want to know how the Prophet conducted himself in public, in private, at home, in the battlefield, in the business, in every arena, you will find him the best. Why? He took the Quran to heart. And this is exactly what the companions did. The companions were not sitting their children memorizing Quran at 7 years old. They themselves were sitting to study the Quran and teach it to their children, but in piecemeals, small parts. One of the companions relate to us how they dealt with the Quran, and they say, we used to study the Quran 10 ayah at a time until we memorize it, until we understand it, until we practice it. Then we move to the next 10 ayah. Imagine how much a child absorbs. If every day you teach a child just one ayah, just one ayah, over a period of 10 years, how much Quran they will have absorbed? Quite a substantial amount. So all what we need to do is to follow on the footsteps of these great generations. Those great generations, they used to love the Quran so much so that when one of them used to travel, he would assign a person that is close to him to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wherever he goes, so that whenever ayat of the Quran were revealed, when he comes back, he would relate it to him. This is how keen they were. They wouldn't come back and say, oh Prophet Muhammad, I was traveling so I missed that part. No, they would get it. They will fill themselves in because they were keen to complete and absorb all the revelation they can. So we need our children, and we ourselves need to start looking at the Quran with that in mind. The Quran is the source of guidance that we all know is the centerpiece of our life, not only here, but also for the hereafter. Unfortunately, many of us are reading much more other things than the Quran. So imagine Allah gives you a new life every day. You wake up in the morning and you have a choice, either to open your day with some Quran or to read the news or to read whatever social media you are on, and you give it your time. But where is the Quran? The same, at the end of the day, you double check again to see other things. So if the Quran is relegated behind us and is left and deserted, we are actually depriving our soul from what makes it what it should be. A Muslim nafs tayyiba. Ya ayyatuha nafsu al-mutma'inna. Mutma'inna means what? Content. Content with what? Content with the revelation, content with Allah as its Lord, content with Muhammad as its Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, content that the Quran is not just a guidance for my personal life, but for everything in my life around me. So that generation was rightly called the Quranic generation, the unique Quranic generation. Jilun Quraniyun Farid. Unique. It was unique in their love of the Quran, in their relationship with the Quran, in their understanding of the Quran, in their practice of the Quran, and the same with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They respected his words. We need our children to get used to be told no, and they should accept it. Our children, even though 16, 17, 18, 19, when you tell them no, they revolt. They revolt. Why do they revolt? Because they are living by whims and desires. They are driven by their whims and desires. They want to be like their peers, no matter what their peers are doing. And they are very good with reasoning their false logic, but that is for them as children. But why are we falling for their false logic? Because most of us, unfortunately, are running by also false logic. Many of us are saying, oh, if I don't do this for him, he may leave the home, he may run away. While this may be true, but by 18, by 17, they are old enough to make choices and learn from their choices. I'm not saying let them go, but I'm saying don't go with them. Don't use their logic as your logic. But again, by that age, if you have not taken care of them when they were young, then come and talk to me how to handle them when they are old. Because it's not an easy question to answer. Every case is different. So we have to be careful, but we cannot bow down to their pressure as they are bowing down to their peer pressure. Otherwise, they will get lost. They will not be able to hold on to Islam if whatever their friends are doing, they have to do. So we need to settle this score with them. We need to teach them the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he says, "La yakun ahadukum imma." Let not any one of you be a following idiot. Imma. يقول أنا مع الناس إن أحسن الناس أحسنت وإن أساءوا أسأت ولكن وطدوا أنفسكم أي عودوا أنفسكم إن أحسن الناس أن تحسنوا وإن أساءوا أن تتجنبوا الإساءة. Get used to that if people do good to you, you do better. And if they do bad, try to avoid whatever bad or evil or harmful that they do. But it is never encouraged in Islam to go with the flow. So that has to be a battle, a fight that you should stand firm to set the red line that should never be crossed. Commitment to Allah, commitment to their religion, discipline in their practice and in their life, and to be respectful of their parents. Those are basics. But now, unfortunately, they demand to be respected. They demand it of their parents. And we say yes, despite their disrespect for parents, their disobedience to their parents. This dynamic has to change. And it will not change on its own. So going back to the basics, we have to have time to raise those children, not only as Muslims, but also as a greater generation than our own. This is the minimum. If they are not better, definitely they are going to be worse. And if not them, their children will be worse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to do our best. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. One of the functions that the mosque used to do at the time of the Prophet ﷺ is the fact that it was like a beehive. Everyone in the community has a role to play. Everyone is volunteering to do something positive for the welfare of the community. But primarily to take care of their own children, to give them the social connection, the friends that they can have, and the ability to do what is good for Islam and Muslims. By the way, in those days, Usama ibn Zayd was leading an army in which Abu Bakr was a soldier. Abu Bakr was a soldier in his army. Usama was between 16 and 17. He was not playing basketball. He was not lured by lollipop He was not tempted by the latest car to agree to go to the mosque with his dad once every other month. You see the standards? You see the difference? So if we keep lowering our standards, our children will also keep taking a lower position. So we need to upgrade and rise up and raise them up to the standards of those great generations. Muslims and non-Muslims alike, they need us, us being the people who come to the masjid and listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The world needs us. The world is full of corruption in every sphere of life. In politics, there's a lot of corruption. In money and business, a lot of corruption. In the social arena, a lot of corruption. In the education, a lot of corruption. In medicine, corruption. Insurance, corruption. Pharmaceutical, corruption. Military, corruption. Who is going to fix all of these if there is no group of any society standing up against all of these types of corruptions? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Let there be an ummah amongst you, a group, a strong bond of a group that stands up against corruption. يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. They invite people to what is good and they stop them from corruption. Corruption in aqeedah is worse than all types of all other corruptions. When the conscience is dead, there is no reform possible. You have to tackle the heart. أَلَا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةٌ إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. In the body, there is a part that if it is righteous and good, the whole body will be righteous and good. If it is corrupt and wicked, the whole of the human will be corrupt and wicked. This is the heart. This is where we need to start. We need our children to recognize the bounties of Allah that He has bestowed upon them and their family and their community, and to start by being grateful to Allah. Children love to know who brought them the gifts that you show them. When you present your kids and say, we had guests and they brought you this and this and this, they want to know who brought these gifts, right? With all the bounties that Allah has given you within your family and around your family and in the community, you should be able to connect them with the mun'im, the giver, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they are connected, then you can teach them. Most of us follow the approach of compliance before conviction. We want them to pray before they understand what prayer is. We want them to be good Muslims before they know what good is and what a Muslim is. No, we need to start by teaching them the basics. La ilaha illallah. They grow up worshipping themselves. Every child is his own God. Because they didn't know that when you say La ilaha illallah, it means you are dismissing yourself as a God. You are not God. And you should never act like one. Not for yourself, not for others. The Pharaonic system itself, which is prevalent in every generation, in every society, everywhere, is based on the fact that there are human gods. That's the basis. In Arabia, it was stone gods. We need to teach our kids that when you enter Islam, you divorce all gods. The kalima of tawheed starts off with La ilaha. There is no God. then but Allah, illa Allah. There is no God with one exception, except Allah. Allah is the only God. We need to go back to those basics with our kids, whatever their age is, to start grounding them and anchoring them firmly in the grounds of their faith, to understand how to make choices, how to make decisions, what path to follow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to do what is right. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. Allahumma aqsim lana min khashyatika ma tahulu bi baynana wa bayna ma'asiyatik, wa min ta'atika ma tubalighuna bihi jannatak, wa min al-yaqin ma tuhawunu bihi alayna masa'ib ad-dunya. Wamatti'na Allahumma bi asma'ina wa absarina wa quwwatina ma ahyaytana, واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. اللهم لا تجعل بيننا محروما ولا تجعل بيننا مظلوما ولا ظالما ولا مكسورا. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأعلي بفضلك يا رب كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان. اللهم أعن المسلمين على تحرير قلوبهم وتحرير بلادهم وتحرير أمتهم من ظلم الظالمين وطغيان الطغاة. اللهم أحينا مسلمين وتوفنا مسلمين وألحقنا بالصالحين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.